First, I want to thank everyone here to give me this invite to come back. This is a big deal for me. Of all the speaking engagements I've made, this is probably by far the best because I get to come back and share. I used to be you. In fact, could you two gentlemen please stand up? Turn around so they can see your face. Okay, these are two gentlemen in the Naval ROTC program. I wanted you to see they're much taller, they're much better looking, and their hair is much shorter than that guy on that picture, okay? But I came here in the Navy ROTC program just to give a little story. I had originally signed up to go to the University of Colorado, and when July came, before you all got here in August, I got a letter from the Navy, and they said you can't come to the University of Colorado because there was a bomb in the ROTC building, and you need to find another school. So I came to Kansas, and after one semester, I loved it here, and when they called me back and said, you go to Colorado, I said, I'm really not interested. But a lot different environment when I sat in your seats where you're at. Well, what I wanted to do today, if we can, have a very relaxed discussion. I've only put together 20 slides. They're very light, with the intent that there's a lot of back and forth. And if you feel more comfortable to hold your comments or discussion at the end, please go ahead and do that. But my goal is, you ask a lot of questions, make a lot of comments, and the smartest person in this room is probably you and not the guy up here, the short guy on the stage, meaning me, okay? So let's try to have an interactive discussion. Leadership is an awesome thing even on your worst day. And I spent about 35 years in the Navy, so I can tell you I had some pretty tough days. But that said, for you to have the ability to hold yourself accountable, to hold the people that work for you accountable, and inspire them to do things they didn't think they could do, and for them to do things you never thought they could do, makes it all worth the while. And I want you to think about leadership and that everything you do when you walk out of here, whether it's a relationship, whether it's a younger brother or sister, whether it's your peers, whether it's the school, whether it's the job, or whether it's the church or volunteer organization, every day you've been given a lot of leadership opportunity. We're going to have a discussion and find out if you're as engaged as you probably should be. All you guys probably, everybody know who this guy is? Please raise your hand if you don't. If you don't. See this like Simon Says. Okay. Vince Lombardi. Leaders are born, aren't born, they're made. They're made just like anything else through hard work. That's the price we have to pay to achieve the good. Okay, I want you to think about that. Okay, let's just ask yourself, pretend there's a mirror up here now. What kind of leader are you today? What kind of leader do you want to become? Think about that for a while. So what I'm telling you, what you need to do today, make a self-assessment. Really look in that mirror, talk to your friends, talk to your boss. More importantly, talk to the people that work for you and just ask them what kind of leader they think you are. And then decide if that's the guy or gal you already want to be or you want to grow to be something else. Okay? Like the three gentlemen in the front, I had the opportunity to be in the Navy. And the Navy was a place where they give you authority and responsibility much earlier than you're ever ready. Okay? I'll give you an example. Most of you guys are probably 18, 19, 20, 21, 22 years old. When I had a CB battalion, I had a company commander show up, 23 years old. He'd been in the Navy and done public works before, facilities management. I said, welcome aboard, come on in. Tomorrow I'm going to put you as the company commander of Charlie Company in the CBs. Look out the window. There's 105 men and women out there on that grinder, and tomorrow morning you're going to be in charge. So the first thing we got to do is make sure you know how to put on your uniform right. Okay? Not getting cute, but he had to blouse a uniform like the skipper has here up front. So one of the questions I asked up front is I said, okay, I'm going to encourage you to be very bold and unafraid and do really bold things because you've got 105 men and women. So they're going to do construction in Rota, Spain for the next 7.5 months. You are their leader. I'm going to give you a chief petty officer who's about 35 years old. He's a salty guy that's been around a long time. He will teach you leadership. You will be married to him. But you're going to make mistakes. So let me ask you this. If you make a big mistake, I want you to answer the question three ways. One, do you admit it? Number two, do you tell your men? And three, do you tell me, the commanding officer? Okay? Which one will terrify you the most? Anybody want to guess? Go ahead, you're first. Me, their men, or himself?
Yourself.
Okay? What do you think? The man. What do you think? Yeah, go ahead.
The man.
Very good. My point was, think about it. If you make a mistake, I want you to come tell me, because I want it to be a learning, growing experience. I want you to learn from it. I don't want to be surprised. But the first thing you got to do is look in the mirror and say, I blew it. Now I got to go see the commanding officer. The hardest thing is to go see those 105 people. For example, pretend they were doing a concrete pour and they didn't have proper training and supervision, and now they had to spend their weekend ripping it out. Now they lost a weekend because he did not get engaged as a leader. How tough a conversation that would be. So I said, I'll get to find out. Did you blame it on me? You blame it on your chief? Did you blame it on somebody else? Or you man up out of the blocks? Because right now, the issue will be you're being measured every single day. Okay? But the biggest thing that Vince Lombardi tells you is leadership is hard. It's a learned experience. It takes a lot of practice. A lot of practice. A lot of new things. And the thing is, he will tell you more than anybody else, results matter. And if you want to make a big difference in leadership, your personal development, it's going to take you a long time. So to get significant results takes time. Everybody recognizes this guy. Okay? Leadership and learning are indispensable to each other. Now, when I graduated from KU, I joined the Navy, like I said, and I went to this place called the Civil Engineer Corps School in the Navy. And as I was telling the skipper, we had all these guys from the Naval Academy there and guys from other ROTC units. Okay? And the first thing they said, man, I'm burnt out. I'm done with school. My mind is just shot. You know what? I'm in the Navy now. I don't ever have to study. I just go to work. Hey, you know, I get all this money. I can't spend all on a weekend on beer and chasing girls. Man, life is good. But let me tell you, I need you to develop a hunger, a fire in your belly to do continuous learning. So please don't leave school. Take those months off. Relax. But no kidding, make a point that if you're going to be a leader, your people will depend upon you growing every single day. And once you get into it, it really gets infectious and you can't get enough leadership training. And that doesn't mean just books. That's talking to people. That's trying new things. That's trying to be your people. But practice, 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 okay? Everybody know this guy? Before you're a leader, success is all about growing yourself. When you become a leader, success is all about growing others. Remember that story I told you about that guy that joined me in Rota, Spain? He'd been in the Navy 2 years. He came to me, he only supervised one person before, and now he's in charge of 105 people on deployment, away from his family in Rota, Spain for 7 months. So my point in this chart is, be careful. This isn't a long duration from the time you're ready by yourself that, boom, you're in charge. So many of you in this room will probably graduate here soon, and you may luck out, and you may go out and be in a leadership job and have 30 people working for you the day or a month after you graduate. Where in the hell did your learning curve go? Why did we take that away from you? Well, you got lucky. Because everyone wants to be in charge. Everyone wants a leadership opportunity. You may be the luckiest person. So now when we talk about that continuous learning and how you get up to speed and how do you learn, those people that you met here at KU, a lot of them on the left or right of you, or maybe in the front row, don't be bashful about calling up somebody and say, gee, what do I do now? Okay? But to me, the leadership is the most accelerating thing I've done in my life. And like I said, the Navy every 2 years moved me to another job that was bigger and badder than the one before, and everyone was a learning curve. It was a sprint for 30 plus years. But my point is on this, as he says, and repeat myself. I'm going to repeat myself a couple times. Do that self-assessment. Know who you are above all else. Before you become a leader of someone else, you better know who you are. Any of you guys see Governor Christie on TV about 2 weeks ago when he had the heckler in the crowd? Anybody see that? Where he told the guy to sit down and shut up? Okay, pretend you're a leader of your organization. How long do you think it would take you to get time between you and that event with the people that work for you? Okay, John Maxwell, great author. A great leader's courage to fulfill his vision comes from passion and not position. That tells you, you don't have, like the previous slide, you don't have to wait 5, 10, 15 years to be in an absolute key leadership job. You may be in one now. And I can tell you the hardest job that I have is to be in a room where I'm the most junior person. How do I learn to shape and to influence and try to get the room to go somewhere else when they're all senior, much more experienced, much smarter than I am? Like, I'm on the ASCE Industry Leadership Council. I joined that. They're all this much smarter and bigger than me. And next thing you know, 2 years later, they go, Mike, we want you to be the chairman. Well, now, not only herding cats, I've got some of the smartest people in the industry, the smartest side of the business, and now we're going to try to get the very best out of them. Okay? But the point on this is empowerment comes from your passion. If you're the most passionate person, you will bring energy, enthusiasm, and excitement, and believe me, it will be infectious. I can tell you, one of the most draining things is to work for a boss that has no passion, no energy, and no excitement. So if that happens to you, then push up as hard as you can. But if you're the boss, or you're the small unit leader, they will look to you to be that informal leader, okay? But take charges. If you're passionate about something, whether it's in your church, your volunteer group, your job, or school, go after it, okay? I'm going to talk about these three guys up front wearing the cloth of the nation, meaning the military. Just my only point for this is I've lost a lot of friends in Afghanistan and Iraq, personal people that I knew, and I just want to talk a little bit about what that 22 or 23-year-old does when they're a soldier going to those places. So what I have up here is a picture named General Montgomery, Monty. He was a World War II general, very famous general, like when you hear MacArthur and Patton and these guys. Leadership is the capacity. When they put those guys in those jobs and they invest in them or give them their charge of hundreds of thousands of men, in World War II it was men, hundreds of thousands of men to go into battles, you had to have your very best generals. Notice the comment, the will to rally men and women. The will or the courage to lead men and women into combat when you know right up front some are going to die and some are going to give their lives for their fellow soldiers or for their country. So it really comes down to courage at the end where it says character which inspires confidence. And we'll pick on the war that Dr. Darwin was in, Vietnam. When I was at KU, I thought I was going to go to Vietnam because it was on when I came here. I heard stories about second lieutenants, 22 and 23-year-olds, went to lead their men and got shot in the back. Blue on blue, or our own soldiers killed officers because they did not want to follow them. So this one here says, did the character inspire confidence that you'll follow this guy into battle when the odds are tough? Do you believe in him? Do you believe in yourself? And you have the kind of unity that you believe in each other. Everyone takes care of everybody else. So if you know any of your friends, or I know anybody that went to Afghanistan or Iraq as a young soldier, sailor, airman, or Marine, please them thank you, because they may have been in charge of four or five people or hundreds, but the bottom line is this is what they had to do every single day when they got up, okay? Everybody know this guy? Oh yeah, we know this guy, huh? Bill Gates, what did he do? He says, leaders will be those who empower others. So think about a guy that takes people to a place no one's ever been before. If you go back 30 years, it was John F. Kennedy say, we're going to put a guy on the moon. Look at what Bill Gates did with what you use every single day. Every issue, every problem, every leadership opportunity is an opportunity to coach, to teach, to mentor, and to empower. So imagine like John F. Kennedy, in this case, Bill Gates, telling you to go to a place no one's ever been before. Look at Apple today and how you guys can't wait to get the latest phone. It's never been done before. So it's not like it's this and it's done. We'll make it cheaper, faster, better. We're going to new frontiers. The only way you're going to get there is if you're the smartest guy in the world, the smartest lady in the world, or you figure out a way to empower all those other people that may be a little smarter than you to just be unbounded. So this is the power of leadership. Like in my case, I'll guarantee you I'm probably the dumbest guy in this room today. How could I get all you guys to work together with a single focus and go ahead and not tell you what the end objective was, just tell you, let's go that way. Find me a journey and go frontier. And I'll guarantee you, you would take off and do things I'd never imagined. You'd probably do things that even pucker me up, because I'm kind of old and unfashioned, but you know what, I'm willing to take that chance. That's what I need you to do when you're in charge. Take off the lid and let people surprise and impress you. The human element. The human element is our most important consideration. Set the tone and create a climate for each and every one to excel. The organization and team grows of individual growth and enthusiasm. So you may have the person at the top. You're only going to be as good as the guy at the bottom, the gal at the bottom. Like when I was in ROTC here working for the skipper. We do a lot of things in the military, like you do a group run. You don't finish till the last person comes over the line. So as you're focused on you that can run 2 minutes faster than me, as you're focused on, I got to get little Mike loose, short legs, bald, how am I going to get him to run faster? Okay? How am I going to teach and coach and train him so our entire company can now beat your company? Okay? But my point is, if you can get the most junior people in your organization fired up, excited, enthusiastic, I used to call it the ice cream sandwich. I could get my senior leadership pretty excited. If I could get my junior people pretty excited, I'd put a lot of heat on that middle management. From the bottom, guys like you bugging them, hey, how come we can't do this? Why can't I do this? Let's go try this. And the senior leadership said the same thing, and the guy in the middle didn't take very long, and he goes, you know what, I better say yes. Okay? But this is where it's at. My point is, if you're a manager, you've heard this a lot in your leadership books, manage by walking around. You have got to get out and be with your people all the time. So take the email and lose it. If you want to tell someone they did a really good job, don't send them an email. Get off your desk, walk down and see them, and just put your hand on their shoulder and come and say, you know what you did yesterday just really impressed me. Knocked my socks off, and I really appreciate what you did. And it's a real big deal. You want to say, you know what, we're going to have a meeting this afternoon. We're just going to get together for about a half hour, and then I pick you and you and you, and we're going to splash you in front of all your friends right here. And the military is pretty good at this. If you really want to splash a big event, not only did I bring you and your friends in, I bring your family in. Nothing's really cooler than to have the spouse and the kids see mom or dad get a big award in front of 600 troops to see dad or mom is really, really special. Okay? Now that doesn't mean everything's goody-goody like I'm talking about. There'll be some tough days. You'll probably be one of those. You'll probably be the hardest worker there is. And then you're going to look around and say, why does that person always get the same thing I get? And they're lazy, and they have a two-hour lunch, and they go outside all the time. Well, part of a leader's job is to make sure that you're fair and you're equitable and disciplined. You hold people accountable. But this is big. If you don't get out and see the people that really, now I'm in a commercial business, public business, these are the people with our clients. These are the people that touch our customers. We're only as good as they are. And when I was in the Navy, at the Naval Facilities Engineering Command, it was contractors like Tito that wore that hard hat, that had those tools, that delivered the building outside Leonard Hall. Okay, well, I was only as good as he was. Was he safe? Did he do quality work? Was he ahead of schedule? was easy to work with on change orders. That's my point. That is who your reputation is, okay? Attitude. I had Dr. Darwin bring me in a little early. I get to see you walk in. I get to measure you right now. Believe it or not, it's not just me up here and you're all looking at me. I get to kind of look around, see who's using their cell phone and who's typing their PC and who's talking to their girlfriend. Who wanted to be here? I joked around with Bruce. He's maintaining a list on everybody. I said, you got to be kidding me. So I'll ask the question. Is anybody here that got told they had to be here? There, an honest man. Oh, now I got 50 of them.
I wanted to be here,
though. Oh, you did? Now I lost my train of thought. All right, attitude. Let me tell you one thing I used to do, and this won't make sense except for the three naval officers. We would have quarters in the Navy. At 6 o'clock every morning, we'd have 600 guys get out in formation. I was the commanding officer. I'd come out and take the report, and here we go. We would do group PT three times a week. So I'd get there about 15 minutes, and I would just kind of walk and watch. I'd just kind of go in the shadows. Not to check on people, not to oversight them. Just see how they're doing. So I could watch you guys walk in like the classroom and say, who's kind of dancing on their feet? Who's kind of floating? Who's got a passion? Who's excited? Who's high-fiving their buddy? Who's the most popular person in this room? Because after a while, I'll find out that you don't walk in here ever by yourself. You walk in here with a group of five or six people because you're the magnet. Who's the person who always sits in the corner by themselves and no one ever talks to them? Well, these are all leadership opportunities for me in the chain of command to bring them up. Like I said, little Mike Luce, the slowest guy. Okay? But what I'm saying, you'd be surprised what you could observe. You'd be surprised what your instructors size up on you before you ask them for that reference letter, that, you know, to give me a reference when I graduate from KU. They've kind of watched you sleep for 3 years in the classroom. They've watched you ask all the hard questions. You played stump the chump with them, and now they get even. Okay? But no kidding, this is something you can really see, and it's infectious. And let me give you an example. Like I said, I don't want to be all fluff and all nice. I'm in now Guam. We got to Guam, and we're doing construction. We're a baby construction company. And we're out there working. And if anybody been to Guam, raise your hands. Anybody been there? That's about normal, two out of a crowd. Okay. Well, anyways, we got there, and it rained for about 40 days straight. And if you've been in Guam, it rains like an inch a day. And we're trying to get construction out of the ground. So we're trying to put in footings, try to put in foundations, try to bring buildings up. So real inventive things, we were using circus tents to dry it off, to basically have using front-end loaders and backhoes under a circus tent to get the footings in the concrete. Really doing Herculean things. Essentially, my story is I would go there in the morning at quarters. It's raining cats and dogs. We're in the rain in essentially uniform like the captain had. Soaked to the gill. And then what do? You get in the back of a crew truck and you go work for 12 hours in the rain, unless you're under that circus tent. Then you come back, then you change your clothes, go eat, then you go to your room, and we had what they called a rolling power outage then in Guam. Every night from 8 to 10, our power went out. So then that meant no air conditioning in Guam, no lights, no electricity from 8 to 10. You got back up at 4:30 to do it again. So that's the kind of pressure they were under. So my story is here. I used to go down and eat in the galley. That's where my men ate, an enlisted galley, once a week. So I'm going through the line like everybody else, and I'm going through, and I said, Dr. Darwin, how you doing? And Tito, how you doing? And how you doing, Skipper? And I get to this young guy who's about 19 years old. I can still see his face, and that was 20 years ago. I go, how you doing this morning? I'm trying to be pumped up and bring the level up. And he uses the S word, begins with an SH, and ends up with TY, and goes blank. And so I said, excuse me, and he goes, shitty. So I took a step back, and I thought, okay. So I took my tray, filled it up, put it over on my table, and I went back and got his chain of command. And I said, look at what that guy is doing. Of all the pressure and all the stuff we got to try to meet these deadlines, I got some guy rolling out at 4:30 in the morning. That's the first thing these guys see before they even go in the rain, to go on the grinder, to go to the job site. That's the way they're going to start their day. The guy was dumb enough, he did it two more times. So what do you do now? Do you fire the guy? Do you throw him out of the Navy? Well, my point was, I said, that's my personal project now. So the next day, when it was still raining like hell, I grabbed this kid and I said, you know what? You get to spend a day with the commanding officer. We're going to go spend 8 hours in the rain and go see the people that you serve every day at breakfast. You know, the same ones that you get to work in a cool place, air-conditioned place, dry place. You're going to go see who your customers are. So then when the kid came back, he was all excited, all pumped up. We didn't kill him, thump him. I just said, see the impact that you had? Think how many people you just ruined their day. 1 month later, this same kid was guy bugging me. I go out on the job sites now, and I go, what's he doing here? Sir, he's supposed to be off, but he made chili and he made hot soup for the troops. And the guy even came up a little thing he called the hot sandwich. This was way before Quiznos and Subways. He made all these sandwiches, rolled them up, moved them for himself, and brought them out to serve the people. So my point, you can be a very negative person or you can make a difference. And 2 months later, after he started that, all the troops swelled and said, we want to make him the CB the quarter because he's had more impact on our construction than our supervision. So my point is, the most junior guy, again, look at the power you got. You don't need to be at the top. I used to show this to all my leadership. I used to talk to a lot of my officers for captains, lieutenant commanders, middle grade, and then ensigns. My point is, ask yourself, where are you at on this chart? This was, again, for captains. I need you to lead them, teach them, encourage them to try and take risks. Well, you know what? We're back to walk the talk. If I tell you to take a lot of personal risk and be bold and unafraid and go out and make mistakes, and I never make any mistakes because I never take my head out of my turtle shell, then am I really the role model? So one thing I'm going to tell you, be careful on what you tell people to do. Make sure you're walking the talk. Now, one advantage I had, and you too will be able to do it, I don't know if other folks can. When I was in the Navy, remember I said that every 2 years they moved me? Well, I was blessed to be a CB battalion commander to go overseas to Rota, Spain, Guam, Puerto Rico, etc. Well, one of the things you're going to do is take over the job, and just like the skipper did, I'm sure, one of the first things you do is you put out your leadership philosophy. Okay? And those are priceless books, kind of like Tom Peters, who used to be in the Navy SEAL Engineer Corps. So I would get on the phone and I would call the commanding officer and everybody I could find and get a copy of their leadership philosophy. A guy taught me real quick, and these young guys that came from the fleet, people will measure you and critique you every day in command, just like you're doing to me now. If you say you're going to do something and you don't do it, you will have no credibility literally in a matter of hours, much less days. So if you're going to put something down in your command philosophy, make sure it's you. So what I did is I took these books, I took a yellow highlighter, remember that, assess yourself, and I really looked at this constructively and said, that's who I want to be, orange highlighter. Yellow highlighter is who I am today. And so my point was, in my philosophy, I only put who I was. I never had to worry about someone saying, that's not you, I would always walk the top. But I wasn't happy with myself. I wanted to be the guy in orange, and I put that on my mirror every morning in the bathroom. I got up, I would look at that thing and say, today, this is what you're going to work on. This is what you're going to practice on. This is what you're going to change. And the next time I went to command, some of those orange things moved to the yellow, and another command, more of the orange went to yellow. So my point is for you, who will not get a military leadership philosophy, take these leadership books that you're reading in your discussions and talk about if that's who you want to be. Remember when I started, what kind of leader are you? What kind of leader do you want to be? But when you talk to your people, make sure you're the real deal. Tell them who you are, and then you work on who you want to be and surprise them and impress them, okay? Observe and adjust. Phrase and discipline. They will be you and you were them. How many of you have kids? Raise your hand in this room, real high. Okay? The most precious leadership job you will ever have is being a mom or a dad, ever. There's no job in the world, they pay you money, but they don't pay priceless. Okay? So your legacy forever will be your children, your grandchildren, maybe even that little brother or sister that mom and dad said you need to mentor them. Okay? So let's talk. You guys study risk here at KU, right? mitigating risk, minimizing risk. All right, let me ask you this. How many of you have ridden a bike? And the reason you kind of give me these strange looks, I did this in Hawaii and people really had not ridden a bike. Okay, so you've all ridden a bike, right? Now, this is going to be a group discussion. Did anybody start riding a bike in this room that didn't have training wheels on it at first? Anybody? So everybody started with training wheels, is that right? Well, I should have known, sir, you'd be the one.
They didn't have training
wheels. Meet our fearless warrior up front. So everyone had training wheels but him, right? All right, so there's going to be three questions, and I'm going to ask the three questions, and I just need you to tell me which one. We're going to start with Mom. Are they old enough to ride a bike yet?
Yeah.
Okay. Okay, so the kid's riding the bike with training wheels. He's got friends. He's got peers. They're getting a little older, and theirs are coming off. So the three questions are, did the kid bug you to say, Mom, Dad, get these things off? Did Dad say, I'm getting embarrassed by the kid, we're taking him off? Or was it Mom that said, enough already, this is my son, my daughter, and they're coming off? So who did it for you?
The kid.
The kid. Okay, raise some hands, who else has kids right by?
Kids?
I have a daughter, yeah.
Okay, anybody else? Any mom or dad in here to say, you're embarrassing me, get them off? No? Really? Who, Matt? You?
Yeah.
Okay. Now, was that a sporty discussion with your wife when you did that?
No.
No. You wear the pants in your family. Is that where we're going here? All right. Where I'm trying to go with this, most people ride a bike, so it's normally a good discussion break. Most places, believe it or not, at Parsons, and I've done this in 10 or 11 locations, the parents took the training wheels off. Anybody want to guess, Mom or Dad, who was the prevalent one that said take them off?
Yeah.
Mom. Okay? So here's my back to the wrist to tie the loop. I work at Parsons. Before I worked in the Navy, I was fixated on getting every sailor I had home that left with me. At Parsons, I'm fixated now on a thing called zero recordables, zero safety incidents. So think about where you're at. As she looked me in the eye, if the most precious thing ever in your world will be your kids, you allow them to ride a bike without training wheels, does anybody not think that that kid, that precious child, is not going to crash and get bruised, scraped, and bloody? Anybody want to say my kid's different and they will never fall off that bike? Anybody want to raise your hand? So if you're willing to take risk with the most precious thing you have in the world when it comes to business where I'm at, then you know what? A business decision ought to be a lot easier for you to make. So I spend my whole time trying to inspire people to be bold and unafraid and make mistakes and do things they never did before. Because you know what, I'll never ask as much from you as what you've already done, and that is to grow, nurture, and have your child ride a bike like you can, to grow up and develop and be a great adult. Okay, so think about that risk. Is it money? Is it schedule? What is it? But think about it, we'll never ask more than that, okay? Mentoring. If you have a mentor, raise your hand as high as you can. Okay, I need them raised higher because it looks like almost a third, okay? All right, let me tell you what a mentor is in my mind, and then I'm going to ask you the question again, and that is, do you have that as your mentor? Okay? Like the chart says, a mentor, I'll just add some stuff that's down on the chart. A mentor has to be accountable. A mentor has to inspire you to be more than you are today and who you want to be. A mentor has to have a high bar. They're going to stretch you and take you to places even you don't want to go. They're going to talk about your personal life. Simple question. How do you define success? How do you define a successful life? If I was to read your obituary today, what would I read? Remember that self-assessment? You're going to do that, and you're going to discuss it in earnest with them. But you know what? They're going to give you more than you got on your sheet. So what are your strengths? What are your weaknesses? What are your gaps? What are the things you need to work on? What are the things that you can control today, and maybe they need to help you? A mentor goes out of their way, like I said, they're accountable, that they're going to change your life. Not just your career, they're going to change your life. They're going to talk about how do you balance self, in your case, deployments, against the job, against family. Some of you guys may have aspirations to run the world. If you're married or you're going to be married, you better be checking with, I call it, commander-in-chief house if you're male. And that is, you better make sure that if you want to be married, kind of like your child, the most precious thing going, and it's your life soulmate, then you know what? You better have that conversation and not do what I saw in the Navy. Hey, hon, guess what? My detailer called me, and we're going to Guam. Oh, really? You didn't talk to me about that in advance? No, isn't that great news? You see what I'm saying? But back to this. Do you have a mentor that inspires you to be somebody bigger than you are today? And it'll look you in the eye and tell you what you need to hear. And for you that later get married or have a partner, I can tell you, that's a lifetime mentor, coach, teacher. Okay, so now let me ask you. If that's your mentor, raise your hand real high. Well, I'm very impressed. I'm very impressed. Because normally I do this, nobody's hand comes back up. Okay? So now, if you have a mentor or someone that thinks you're a mentor and they're not signing up for that, please have an adult, robust discussion with them. And if they don't come around or you don't think they're really going to grow and maximize your personal professional development, then please fire them. Okay? Get another one. So now, we all talk like you're that guy like we talked about before with Jack Welch. Train self before you train others. I can tell you, one of the most selfless things is you become the mentor for many others. So if you want to give back, take under your wing, nothing's better than your kids, but take under your wing someone that you can develop and really grow them. Okay? Please think about that. Because if this room went out and you all touched three or four people, just imagine how many people that is, like Amway, and in 10 or 12 years, we would probably have thousands of people that are much better person, much better career, because you know what? You started it all. You started that forest fire. This is the most important thing about leadership. Of all the things I talk about today, this is the one to hammer home. It's all about honesty and integrity, and it's all up front. Lots of slogans if you read books. Don't do anything your mom, or in fact, the first one I guess, don't do anything you wouldn't want to see on the front page of the Washington Post. When I was in the Seabees, the comment was, don't do anything that would embarrass your mom. Okay? You all heard about the golden rule? Has everybody heard about the golden rule? What's the golden rule? Anybody going to speak up? What do you think golden rule is?
As you would have done to yourself.
Right. So when I got to be in the CEO of a public work center, a blue-collar organization, it was exactly as you two described the buddy system here. Do unto others as you would like to be treated yourself. I'm down there with all these blue-collar workers, really tough, burly guys. And four-letter words were how they talked. And getting drunk most of the time was how they did. And they wrestled around. They were pretty cool. Well, we had women join the workforce. So back to the slogan of treat them how you like to be treated. Well, bring her in out of the fold, and we'll teach her four-letter words and how to be vulgar and bold. And so I changed that. I call it the platinum rule. Treat people the way they would want to be treated. Well, they didn't quite get it. So one day, my most boisterous guy, I invited somebody to come visit that day. And I said, remember I gave you guys this discussion about the platinum rule and I just couldn't get through because I'm not smart enough. So I'd like you to meet two people here. I brought in his mom and I brought in his daughter. So then we change it from now on, the blue collar shops. You treat each other the way you would treat your mom or would you want someone to treat your daughter? And it was amazing. In about 2 weeks, they didn't know whose mother I was going to bring back, and things got fixed. Okay? But back to this integrity. Please do the hardest, toughest things. They will build your character. If we talk about character, if you want to challenge your personal character, do the hard, tough things. Don't procrastinate on the hard, tough things. I've had to do reductions in force where I had to give pink slips to people. I had to go to funerals, too many. I had to give flags to mom and dads and spouses. And I had to do a lot of things that, you know what, have been easy just to do it. But I never did the easy way out. Because I can tell you, if you're in leadership or you're ever in command, like the commanding officers, you are in a fishbowl. Every single thing you do will be measured, assessed, and talked about. Well, I only cheated on my travel claim one time. That's the one they found. And guess what? We can't trust that guy or gal because they cheated on their travel claim. He said he worked at 10 o'clock at night. Hell, I saw him at the gym at 7. You told me you'd be there for me. Why didn't you show up? So it's all down to trust. If people trust you, and like the example of General Montgomery, they may put their lives at stake. These three gentlemen here signed an oath that they would give their life for their country, and they would give their life for their shipmate, and then they'd worry about themselves. Or like you saw that movie, Lone Survivor, that is the real deal. But if you don't have trust, who is ever going to do that for you? So my point is, whatever you do, if it's really, really hard, ask for help. Get some assistance. Talk to somebody, like that mentor. Talk to a peer. If you make a mistake, please admit it up front. Take full responsibility for it. People really do good on free. Give them all the credit. But it really comes down to, here's my point. Are they really excited they can't get to work because you're their boss? Are you worried about their personal and professional development? Will you be there for them when they need it? Will you be there for them when it's hard? If the answer is no, then you know what? They'll only give you something less than 100%. Safety. I grew up at KU, and you know what? We talked about safety. When we were here, we talked about fatalities, construction fatalities. Today, the industry doesn't talk about construction fatalities. They talk about recordables. And the better companies, like Tito here in the front row, they talk about zero safety incidents. My point is, if you're a leader, you not only have a responsibility, you have an obligation for the safety and welfare of everybody that works for you. Kind of like the slogan of these three guys here, you got to bring them all back, all in one piece, all safe and sound. Well, I can tell you, if you're going to get zero safety incidents, traditional ways are not going to get there. For you guys and gals, you're going to go out and run a workforce, a union workforce, a workforce that's 45 or 50 years old. I've done it this way for 30 years. I know more than you do, young kid. Get over it. Because you know what? They got to completely change. Traditional ways will not get us to where we need to be. Okay? Now you're a leader. You're the boss. They want your time. I can tell you, when you get to be a leader and you've got a lot of people, that 8 hours a day or 10 hours a day don't exist. It becomes longer because you know what? You just can't fit it in. So think about it, kind of like a relationship. Hey, I'm here for you. Why aren't you here for me? What happens when you got 17,000 people working for you? How do you spread your time? How do you give them what they need? But I can tell you, don't kid around at this. Someone will need your special care and concern. There are real events going on in your organization. Marriages are coming apart. Someone's having some real problems. You need to go out and know what they're doing, but real genuine concern. Now, the other thing you'll hear, I bet you all work for a company that says people are number one. Okay? What's our number one asset? Our people. Who do we put first? Our people, just like you with your child. Well, if I'd never see the manager, you never see the boss, are you a number one on their priority list? So if people are really your number one, you get out and go see them, and here's where we're at. So my point is, now you got a picnic. And you got your senior managers, then you got your middle managers, and you got your junior managers. And it's kind of funny that when you go to these, there's all the senior guys, there's the middle guys, there's the junior guys. There's all you guys looking at your watch going, man, when is this class over? Okay? If you really enjoy people and you're really the genuine leader, you're going to enjoy spending time with them. And you know what? It takes 2 minutes. At that potluck, go sit with them. Especially for a junior guy to go sit with a senior guy. You know what? That's brown nosing, right? Nah. Okay? Do it anyways. Get the group together. You may be the one pushing the senior leadership to really care about that person at the deck plate, that lowest person. But put their welfare above them. And the main thing, teach and grow, okay? But the real thing is, if you're not excited when you go to work, you can't wait to leave breakfast. In fact, you want to skip breakfast because I can't wait to get to work. Then make that infectious, make that energy push. But if you're not, then look in the mirror and say, why not? The problem may be your boss, may be your peers, you may not be challenged. Bump on the boss and say, you got to give me more to do, more responsibility, or you know what, we need to liven things up here. Let's go to a ball game, let's go on a ski trip, let's get to know each other, okay? We talked about General Montgomery. We'll take it to the private sector. If you're going to be the coach, you're going to be the teacher, you're going to be the mentor, and you're going to empower these guys and gals, you better know the business. You better be a master of the business. And you better practice. Because it really comes down to, if we're going to take some risk and go to places no one's ever gone before, back to that comment about the second lieutenant getting shot in Vietnam, do we trust our leader to be there for us? Are they technically grounded? Do they know the business? Are they a good leader? Will they stand up? So you really, they need to have confidence in you. If they have confidence in you, then they're going to have more confidence in themselves, because you know what? You can brace them up. You can catch them. You can correct them. You can adjust them like this previous slide here. Okay? But if you don't know what the hell you're doing and they're out alone on the end of that branch, it's a pretty scary place. Okay, everybody know this guy? We already saw his picture, right? This should be easy. All right, when I was a second grader, that's how old this picture is, my dad came home and put this thing on the wall in our living room. So that's how much this means to me. And it says, ask not what your country can do for you, ask what you can do for your country. And if you look at this week, it's been a pretty sporty week in America. So we're going to blow through two other slides and put them together. President Harry Truman said, men and women make history and not the other way around. Progress occurs when courageous, skillful leaders seize the opportunity to change things for the better. Engineers are global leaders building a better quality of life. Okay? So we talked about the individual, you, growing, learning as fast as you can, because in 2 years you may be it. Now you're the leader, and as Jack Welch said, you're responsible for this entire team here. And now I'm taking you to where Tito's at every day. The give back, the pay ahead. This is about community. This is about America. This is about the globe. So now you get to decide, if you go back to the land of the Romans, who built the first aqueducts and the first water systems, look at what infrastructure is today for you. I left Washington, D.C. last night. I flew here. I got in a car. I drove on a road. I got to the hotel. Just like this, I got power. What I do, like you, the first thing I did was click on my laptop, go on my cell phone, go to work. Gee, that air conditioner, that heat felt pretty good last night. Gee, that shower this morning felt pretty good. Okay, all the things you take for granted, you know that 10% of the world has no access to clean water whatsoever. Their longevity is probably 30 years less than you just because they can't drink clean water. So what I'm leading up to, if you're an engineer, raise your hand real, real high. Any kind of an engineer. Okay? Now, put those down. If you're not an engineer, raise your hand real high. You can raise it higher than that. Okay? And what do you guys do? Out loud. What's your major? Hold it, you're an engineer then?
Well, yeah,
All right, here we go. I'm sorry, you're right. He told me this would happen. All right. If you're going to graduate and be an engineer of any kind or an architect, please raise your hand real, real high. Okay? Now, put them down. If you're going to graduate and not be an engineer or an architect, raise your hand real high. Really, none? What do you guys do? Out loud.
Public administration.
Okay? Two PA guys, okay. Now, that a chart applies to you. So here's where I'm going back to infrastructure, and you're all in this game. So I'm asking for your help for my grandkids that don't exist yet, meaning future generations. Your kids, your grandkids, and their future generation. If you look at infrastructure, it's everything. It's the schoolhouse we're in. It's how we move all the goods in the world. Everything you're wearing, everything you eat, everything you do came on some form of transportation. It's all the electrical. It's all the water. It's the wastewater. It's all the telecommunications. Everyone moves financial electronically. Well, guess what? No one's putting money back into that. You've heard America's infrastructure's getting tired. It's declining. And you see on TV, we're not putting money in it. Well, that's your kids' future. That's your grandkids' future. So my point is this. Like Tito's doing, please get engaged at your community level. Lead, shape, and influence people, appointed and elected officials, to do the hard right things. They're going to need facts. They're going to need convincing arguments. They're going to need to know with the failure if they do nothing. They're going to need to know how infrastructure is a critical enabler. It's not an end in itself. It enables all those things. So my point is today, if you watch TV this week, and you've all seen TV the last several years, we're into a, probably getting in trouble here. You're not supposed to do this on tape, but we're in a place where we need strong leadership, and we need people to have the light. So like Bill Gates, we need to fix things globally and the world and your community. Please get engaged just like Tito's doing. Volunteer for organizations. Get an ASCE. Get in other organizations that have a voice and please help. Because the silent majority is not going to fix it. So if you go back to this guy right here, help those skillful leaders seize the moment and fix it. And you may be one of those. Some of you may be politicians in this room. And if you are, I'm just grateful for you to have that moral courage, not only for you, but for your family, to go run things. Please do. But if you're not one, please help those people that do. But please get out and vote, and please influence and help us make things much better. And my point is, if I look back at my great-grandfather and grandfather and my dad, everyone is living much better than their predecessor. You get to decide whether your kids live much better than you do, and their grand and your grandkids live much, much better than they do. So it all starts here. I mean, you're the engineers, and our two PA guys. I mean, this is a big, big deal, okay? Don't wait on somebody else. Push up if you're not the one at top. What did he do, blow them all? Wasn't paying attention. I guess I'm done. All right. So my final comment is, how much time we got, sir?
Well, let's say max 10 minutes.
All right, please, any comments, questions? I don't believe what you said. Whatever, just go loud as I'll ask. Please, go ahead. The question was, as you talk about young leaders, the comment is made that young leaders are adverse to risk. Is that correct?
Yeah.
Okay, I can tell you personally from being in the Navy and looking at guys like this right here, it's the exact opposite. Okay, let me give you a little example when I was in Rota, Spain one time. Anybody seen the movie We Were Soldiers? Has anybody ever seen that movie? I didn't think you had. Okay. Anyways, we were there, and we were supposed to, we had 37 jobs we were supposed to do in 7 months, and one of these was to do a racquetball court. Essentially come in like this building here, knock this wall down, extend it 20 feet, put in a new racquetball. We're only supposed to put in the foundation. I had a kid 19 years old, and I had a crusty master chief. That was my example of, we were so really crusty guy. Master Chief, where's that front end loader? When are you going to get that bucket truck here? Where's that front end loader? He goes, kid, shut up. Well, he comes around about a second time, Master Chief. I go, what are you doing, Master Chief? And he goes, watch this. And he gives this kid a gigantic sledgehammer. And I go, what the hell are you doing? He goes, watch, we're going to humble this kid. He's got too much energy, too much enthusiasm. We drive around for about 4 hours checking all the other jobs, and we come back, and lo and behold, not exaggerating, that corner there is 20 feet high, and we come back, and this much of the wall from that corner there gone in 4 hours. It was, if you've been to Europe, they use hollow block, which is really like clay roof tile, and they just put plat. This kid started on the bottom, he looked at it, he got a ladder, went up and chopped that side, came here and chopped this way, and went up, and then halfway up the building just fell over. So I said, okay, if this kid's that empowered, Master Chief, I've seen enough. Let's see what he can do. I gave him five people. And next thing you know, they're going 100 miles an hour. This kid was so good back to the risk, picking on the officers, which I used to be one, out of college. He says, hey, you know what, officers, we're going to give you a chance to show you how to do CMU block, lay some block, how to do some plaster, and how to put it together. So what do you think? I'm going to run a training Saturday for you guys. Come on out. So now you got a kid 19 years old, military terms, an E2, having officers, which is an 01, 2, and 3, teach them. It's like you taking Dr. Darwin and bringing him in here and saying, let me teach you how to do structures. Okay? These guys were so fired up and pumped up because now they learned something. They want to go back the next Saturday. We were supposed to be done 40% at the end of the deployment on this one project. 3 months later, it was done, and I pinned a Navy Achievement Medal on this kid. I can tell you, my other example is I was in the Public Works Center in Hawaii, and I told people, which I'll tell you, I had all my senior leadership, and I said, I said, I have this much tolerance for mistakes. I have this much tolerance for surprise. And if you ever embarrass me, it's going to be a tough day in my office. So then I had a guy make a mistake. He came up and told me about it. So the next day, I gathered all you guys. I grabbed all their senior leadership. And I said, sir, please go ahead and tell them about the mistake you made and what we learned. And then I gave this guy a plaque and a letter of accommodation for having the moral courage to admit he made a mistake to grow the rest of us. I did it. About 6 months later, because this is a blue-collar organization, about 1,400 people, I said, okay, now that you guys are pumped up and you're bold and unafraid, you can make mistakes, they're learning and growing experience, let's go ahead and spread the wealth. So let's go to the layer below and you continue this like Amway. I made a blushback. Sir, you don't understand, these are blue-collar workers. Man, they'll put you in jail. They'll put you in prison. We can't give them that kind of authority. We can't give them that kind of responsibility. So here, in two minutes, so we in the government, we used to do what they called an A76, commercial studies. Basically, we would take the government jobs and compete them against contractors. And to win, you had to cut about 30% to win. So we had to do a big job on our compound. And so everyone is watching this, because all the contractors are flying into Hawaii now to go beat this, you know, take over these jobs. So I said, we're in the microscope, boys and girls, and this is it. Well, we had to do this major rehab and pretend it's Tito. And he says, okay, I need 8 months to design it. And then we got 2 months of material. And then we'll mobilize in 10 months. And then we have a 3-month duration. Now, remember, I trust people back to your comment. These are the more junior people, the blue collar work. And I said, what do you think? I said, if we do that, we'll never have a job. Every contractor will beat us out, because that ain't how Tito works. So those blue-collar workers, this guy stood up, back to your comment, 27 years old, raised his hand and said, sir, we can be done in 60 days. And Tito's saying, he's pushing back. Said, yeah, we already had that discussion, but, you know, that's a year from now. And he says, no, I can start today, and I can be done in 60 days. All I need you to do is take the pyramid, which is what your question is, and flip it upside down. And he says, you let me run this thing and make that engineer, that designer work for me, make that material guy work for me, and make the HR people work for me. And he says, well, I said, what are you telling me? He says, you know what? If you let me start, the guy got 3 Bobcats. Everybody knows what a Bobcat is? It's almost, they put, I call it headache gear on top of them. They put cages on top. And they're like driving around a demolition derby. They were just knocking walls down inside this building. If they weren't structural, they just collapsed. At the end of that day, 6 hours later, this building, about 3 times the size of this, was completely empty of any partitions. other than you saw electrical stub outs and plumbing stub outs. And the comment was, now that I did this, we're going to put in systems furniture. You do the phone outlay, you do the systems furniture, you give me the power drop, and you give me the air conditioner, and I'll be ready for you in 2 weeks, 3 weeks, 4 weeks, and 5 weeks. They were done in 57 days. So in answer to your question, you're going to find when you go out there, senior leadership will be more conservative because he and I answer the bottom line. Middle management will protect he and I. And the most junior people go, we don't have any empowerment, we don't have any authority, we don't have the ability to get things done. So I can tell you, if you work for me, back to that ice cream sandwich, I would take you, fire you up, put you on fire. I'd put the people on top like my example, and we'd get that middle management to push. And after about 2 or 3 years, if they didn't get out of your way, then you would be them. Okay? So be bold and unafraid. Just don't ever hurt anybody is all I ever ask. Okay? I mean, people's safety is number one. And he'll tell you from a guy that's been doing it forever, quality is key. You do concrete, it's a 50-year event. You screw that up, people for 50 years admire your shoddy work. Okay? Any other comments? Please be bold. Be unafraid. Okay? One final comment before I go. We talked about mentors, and I want to say this at the end. Dr. Darwin, sir, could you please stand up? This is the guy that got me started, okay? So when you get upset, who invited this little short, bald, fat guy? This is the guy. But seriously now, I was here dressed like you. Believe me, it's a lot more fun to be dressed like you. And I was his guy that ran his concrete lab. And like these two guys, I wore a uniform once a week in Navy ROTC. And he grabbed me and said, Mike, I see you're in the Navy, you're in the ROTC program. What are you going to do? Well, I'm going to join the Civil Engineer Corps and go in the Navy Seabees. Well, Mike, I used to be in the Corps of Engineers in Vietnam, and we were literally doing the exact same thing as you. So my point is, instead of me chasing a mentor, Dr. Dave Darwin chased me. Not only did we have discussions what I needed to do when I hit the Navy to hit the ground running, more importantly, he talked about, hey, Mike, what do you want to do in life? How do you define success? You got a girlfriend. Are you serious? Are you going to get married? You need to think about married life in the military. And most important, like you gave the answer, always take care of those men and women first. So I can tell you, you may have your best mentor. They'd be in the room. And I can tell you mine is right there. Thank you, sir. That's it.